Welcome to Digging Deeper for episode 10 of Tilling the Soil. I'm your host, Mr. Jason. Thank you for joining me once again. And before we begin, let's get to some announcements. Every Sunday morning, come out to CCGC Family Ministry Sunday services in the Summit Building at 8, 9:30, and 11:15 a.m. Join Pastor Steve, Miss Steph, Mr. Kyle, and Mr. Jeff as they take you through the entire Bible one week at a time. Next up, we have Tilling the Soil, premiering every Monday night at 7 p.m. Join me on the CCGC YouTube channel as I try to help make fertile the soil of your heart by expanding on the Bible lesson from Sunday mornings. On Wednesday nights, come on out to CCGC Family Ministries Midweek in the Summit Building at 7 p.m. Join Pastor Steve and Mr. Jeff for a lesson in God's Word with an extended game time and craft time with Miss Carolyn. And of course, on Thursday nights at 7 p.m., join me for what you're watching right now, Tilling the Soil, Digging Deeper, as we round out our week of learning with a chance to dive deeper into God's Word. And first things first, let's begin in prayer. Dear Lord, thank you for allowing us to gather once again digitally as a small group on a Thursday evening. Lord, I know that these gatherings have been typically smaller than the Monday nights. But Lord, please help this program to grow as well. That way, more people are getting to hear your word spoken about. Getting to look deeper at your word and just spending more time in your word. So Lord, please open our hearts, soften our hearts, and help us to look at the glory of your word here this evening. And I pray these things in the name of your son, Jesus. Amen. And let's kick off our Thursday study as we always do. And let's see how this week's lessons connect back to Christ. As we see in our Christ connection, God called Jonah to go to his enemies and call them to turn away from their sin. But Jonah refused. Instead, he ran away. Later, God sent Jesus to his enemies to call us to repentance. God willingly obeyed. Jesus died on the cross to rescue us from sin. On Monday, we spoke about Jonah and his time as prophet in the northern kingdom of Israel. Jonah was sent on a successful mission to Nineveh to get them to repent of their wicked ways and turn back to the Lord. Or turn to the Lord, I guess. These events more than likely happened between 786 and 746 BC, which was the reign of Jeroboam II, which is important to remember now as we look at the downfall of the northern kingdom of Israel from 2 Kings chapter 17, verses 1 through 41. In the 12th year of Ahaz, king of Judah, Hosea, the son of Elah, became king over Israel and Samaria and reigned for 9 years. He did evil in the sight of the Lord, but not as the kings of Israel who came before him. Shalmaneser, the fifth king of Assyria, came up against him, and Hosea became his servant and paid him tribute money. I find it interesting that scripture notes that King Hosea did evil in the sight of the Lord, but not as the other kings had. Not through idolatry, but as becoming servant to the king of Assyria. But the king of Assyria discovered a conspiracy in Hosea, who sent messengers to So, the king of Egypt, and offered no tribute to the king of Assyria, as he had done year by year. Therefore, the king of Assyria arrested him and bound him in prison. Then the king of Assyria invaded all the land of Israel and went up to Samaria and besieged it for 3 years. In the 9th year of Hosea, the king of Assyria took Samaria and carried the people of Israel into exile to Assyria and settled them in Halal and Habar by the river Gozan and in the cities of the Medes. King Hosea tried to remove the oppression by the Assyrians by offering the money he had been giving to King Shalmaneser to the Egyptian king So. Instead, but unfortunately for the king of Israel, the Assyrians found out. Apparently, as I've read and heard, historically at that time, Assyria had a very intricate, very deep and detailed spy operation all over the Middle East. And just as a reminder of how powerful the Assyrians were, they had the king of Israel arrested, the king of another nation taken prisoner, and that was 3 years before the war ended. One thing to keep in mind, one sad thing in my opinion, about the fickle hearts of humans. The northern kingdom of Israel fell in 721 BC, fell to the wicked and powerful armies of Assyria. 721 BC, only about 50 or so years after the entire nation of Assyria was led to repentance and forgiveness by Jonah. That's it. About two generations. Then a new king rose to power and the wickedness began once again. That's why they say each generation has to make their own way to God. Each generation has to forge their own relationship, because each new generation will be tempted away from the Lord in a different way. The enemy is always devising new schemes, new plans of his own to trip us up and cause us to stumble. But the path to salvation remains the same, unchanging. Faith in the shed blood of Christ. Now this came about because the Israelites had sinned against the Lord their God, who had brought them up from the land of Egypt, from under the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and they had feared and worshipped other gods and walked in the customs of the pagan nations, whom the Lord had driven out before the sons, descendants of Israel, and in the pagan customs of the kings of Israel, which they had introduced. The Israelites ascribed to the Lord their God things that were not true. They built for themselves high places of worship in their towns, from the lonely lookout tower to the populous fortified city. They set up for themselves sacred pillars, memorial stones, and the asherim on every high hill and under every green tree. There they burned incense on all the high places, just as the pagan nations whom the Lord had deported before them. And they did evil and contemptible things, provoking the Lord to anger. And they served idols, of which the Lord had said to them, "You shall not do this thing." We believers are often asked why. Why would God allow this? Why would he allow his children he loves so much to face judgment? Well, the scripture tells us. His children turned from him and turned to sinfulness, turned to momentary happiness, turn to what was right and good in their own eyes. These sins aren't insignificant things. Sin need to be punished. Yet the Lord warned Israel and Judah through all his prophets and every seer, saying, "Turn from your evil ways and keep my commandments and my statutes, in accordance with all the law which I commanded your fathers, and which I sent to you by my servants the prophets. However, they did not listen, but stiffened their necks as did their fathers, who did not believe, trust in, rely on, remain steadfast to the Lord their God. They rejected his statutes and his covenant which he made with their fathers, as well as his warnings that he gave them." And it's not like he didn't warn them. God gave his children second chance after second chance, warning after warning. God was so patient, he essentially became the comic relief father on TV saying, "You better stop before I get to the count of five. One, two, three, four, four and a quarter, four and a half, 4 9/16. How many more chances should his children have had? Honestly. Because this is the thing we need about God that we need to understand. God must punish sin. It's not because he can't control himself like people like to mock, but it's because he is altogether righteous and just. He is perfectly righteous and just. And to be perfectly just means he needs to see justice done. If he withholds justice from those who are completely unrepentant, then he isn't perfectly just. He's showing favoritism. Then, if he shows favoritism, he'd be no better than us humans. But he isn't like us. He understands that true and perfect justice looks cruel sometimes to those who don't understand it. But perfect justice isn't about making everyone happy. And honestly, we humans aren't even capable of understanding perfect justice, even if we were to see it. Because we can't let go of our flawed sense of vengeance. They followed vanity and became vain. This verse I could only find in the King James Version and the Amplified translations of the scripture, at least of the translations I normally check, because I normally go about through about five or six of them when I look at verses. The New King James Version, which I normally study out of, changed the wording to followed idols and became idolaters, which isn't wrong. If anything, it's probably more accurately worded. But I love the King James Version here. They followed vanity and became vain. Vanity. Emptiness. The Israelites followed emptiness. That's what idols are. After all, empty man-made things. And became vain. They became empty. We don't realize it, not right away at least. But when we chase after idols, chase after things of this world that we allow ourselves to place before God, the sports, the money, the career, the perfect husband or wife, the cause that the world claims to be the thing to be involved with at the current moment. When we chase after these idols, we aren't just chasing emptiness. We're becoming empty ourselves. We're emptying ourselves of everything of value to fill ourselves with momentary flakes of happiness that'll be blown away on the wind tomorrow. Parents, how many times do we look around and see people afflicted with emptiness? We need to stay full in His Spirit. We need to continue to fill our children. We need to stay in His Word continually, not just on a Sunday. Maybe sprinkle a Wednesday in there. Because our sinful nature yearns for the emptiness of the world. But His Word won't be blown away. Not tomorrow, not ever. Because nothing can blow away eternity. They followed the pagan practices of the nations which surrounded them, although the Lord had commanded that they were not to do as they did. They abandoned all the commandments of the Lord their God and made for themselves cast images of two calves. And they made Asherah idols and worshipped all the starry host of heaven and served Baal. They made their sons and their daughters pass through the fire as human sacrifices and used divination to foretell the future and enchantments. And they sold themselves to do evil in the sight of the Lord, provoking Him to anger. Therefore the Lord was very angry with Israel and removed them from His sight. None of the tribes was left except the tribe of Judah and Benjamin, because Benjamin and Judah became one tribe. The northern kingdom of Israel hadn't just fallen into having false idols. They had fallen into serving them, not just worshiping at a couple of statues or golden calves, but had taken the following and acting out the incredibly wicked and brutal rituals and religious ceremonies of the false pagan gods and priests. Some deeds and rituals so wicked I can't even explain them on a program with children watching. And the Lord in His perfect justice couldn't allow them to continue on in the way they were going. So He had to remove them from His land. Remember, the promised land was His, that He gave to the Israelites as an inheritance. Judah did not keep the commandments of the Lord their God either, but walked in the customs which Israel introduced. Now the southern kingdom of Judah wasn't exactly doing as they were supposed to either. But their saving grace, at this point at least, was the fact that they had at least a few kings who'd done right in God's eyes by trying to bring the people to repentance, where the northern kingdom had zero. Not a single good king ascended to the throne in the north. So the Lord rejected all the descendants of Israel and repeatedly afflicted them and handed them over to plunderers until he had them cast out of his sight. When he had torn Israel from the royal house of David, they made Jeroboam the son of Nebat king. And Jeroboam drove Israel away from following the Lord and made them commit a great sin. For the Israelites walked in all the idolatrous sins which Jeroboam committed. They did not turn from them until the Lord removed Israel from his sight, just as he had foretold through all his servants and prophets. So Israel went into exile from their own land to Assyria to this day, the day of this writing. Think of all the prophets of the northern kingdom. Amos, Jonah, Elijah, Elisha, Micaiah, who we really didn't even cover. All the prophecies that continued to fall on deaf ears. Why did God? Why so harsh? Why so judgmental? That's what we are always being questioned with. But no one ever stops to think about, why didn't the Israelites just stop and listen? Over and over, the prophet screamed, stop! If you're walking down the street and someone screams, stop! Don't you stop? Well, we really need to ask ourselves why the Israelites didn't. Because if we start asking those questions, then we'll need to look deeply at our own lives. Is God screaming for us to stop? Are we ignoring that pull on our own heart? We need to think about these things. The king of Assyria brought men from Babylon and from Cutha and from Ava and from Hamath and Sepharvaim and settled them in the cities of Samaria in place of the sons, the people of Israel. They took possession of Samaria and lived in its cities. Really, I really thought I was going to have problems with Sepharvaim and not Cutha. Whatever. This was a common tactic by the Assyrians to keep their captives, their slaves, from rebelling against them. They would split up the different groups and then place small amounts of them together in places that weren't their home countries. That way they had trouble communicating because they spoke different languages. And because they weren't familiar with the area they now found themselves in, it's kind of hard to run if you don't know where you're running. Now, when they began to live there, they did not fear the Lord. Therefore, the Lord sent lions among them, which killed some of them. So the king of Assyria was told, "The nations whom you sent into exile and settled in the cities of Samaria do not know the custom of the God of the land." So he has sent lions among them. And they are killing them because they do not know the manner of worship demanded by the God of the land. Then the king of Assyria commanded, "Take back to Samaria one of the priests whom you brought from there, and have him go and live there, and have him teach the people the custom of the land." These verses may seem odd at first glance, but this is God delivering a warning to the new peoples living in the land, sure, but mostly to the Assyrians in charge. A warning that you may have conquered and scattered the people of Israel, but the God of Israel is still in control. And you are only successful by the hand and the will of the Lord. Basically, this is my land for my people. Don't get too comfortable here. So one of the priests whom they had exiled from Samaria came back and lived in Bethel and taught them how they should fear and worship the Lord. But every nation still made gods of its own and put them in the houses, the shrines of the high places which the Samaritans had made. every nation in the cities where they lived. The men of Babylon made Succoth-Benoth. The men of Cuth made Nergal. The men of Hamath made Ashima. The Avonites made Nebaz and Tartak. And the Severites burned their children in the fire of Adrammelech and Ammonamelech, the gods of Sepharvaim. And they also feared the Lord and appointed from among themselves priests of high places who sacrificed for them in the houses of the high places. They feared the Lord, yet served their own gods, following the customs of the nations from among whom they had been sent into exile. They feared the Lord, yet served their own gods. Every message I've listened to, every commentary I've looked at, said the same thing. How little distance we've covered as a people. Last time I've read or seen a survey, it said that just over 70% of the people in the United States identified as Christian. But look around. Seriously, look around you. Does it seem like 7 out of every 10 people you know follow Christ? Now, this is just one anecdote, but my daughter was in her third grade class, and they were going around the room asking different questions of the students. And when the question was asked, "Are you a Christian?" she was the only student who stood up. That's not 7 in 10. That's 1 in 28. Which honestly seems about right to me, if not even a little too high. So many times I've been on the outside as an observer on social media, reading conversations where one self-professed Christian would ask another something along the lines of, "Why do you believe that?" or "Why would you feel that way about this situation?" And for me, the answer's just always so easy. And if they were a real Christian, they'd already know the answer. Because honestly, I'm one of those really stupid Christians who doesn't really have a doctrine, a way of studying the Bible. I just simply read the text and see what it says and see what the Spirit reveals to me. If there's something I still don't know, I look deeper at a commentary or something. I look at the Bible and I believe what it says. And the answer to almost all these questions that you see asked is because it says it in the Bible. Just read the thing. See, so many people claim to fear God, but they aren't willing to worship Him or to be obedient to Him. We need to pray for those people, but most importantly, we need to make sure that we don't find ourselves numbered among them. We need to make sure that we continue to keep ourselves set apart for the Lord and the Lord alone. To this day, they act in accordance with their former pagan customs. They do not really fear the Lord, nor do they obey their statutes and ordinances, nor the law, nor the commandments which the Lord commanded the sons, the descendants of Jacob, whom He named Israel, with whom the Lord had made a covenant and commanded them, saying, "You shall not fear other gods, or bow yourselves to them, nor serve them, nor sacrifice to them. But the Lord who brought you up from the land of Egypt with great power and an outstretched arm, Him you shall fear, and to Him you shall bow yourselves down, and to Him you shall sacrifice. The statutes and the ordinances and the law and the commandments which He wrote for you by the hand of Moses, you shall observe and do forever. You shall not fear, worship, serve other gods. The covenant that I have made with you, you shall not forget. You shall not fear other gods, but the Lord your God you shall fear and worship. Then He will rescue you from the hands of your enemies." Even in the midst of judgment, of punishment, the Lord brings forth blessings and promises, abounding in love and forgiveness. I've spoken about this several times already, but the Lord's punishment comes from love. I know unbelievers have a hard time with that concept, and we have a hard time with that concept when we're the ones being punished. But that's because Unbelievers, I'm not sure, truly understand the depths love can go. When you truly love someone, you want the best for them. And when they're heading into dangerous territory, you do whatever you can to get them to change course. I remember with both my kids when they were younger. I mean, like smaller. If they were walking in danger, perhaps a road, not paying attention in a parking lot, or about to get run over by a runaway shopping cart because they weren't paying attention, I'd grab them by the hair and pull them back. They'd scream and be hurt, I'm sure, and angry. But I'm tall, and they were little. So their hair was the only thing I could reach. It was my only option. So that became their correction, their bit of punishment that was necessary to keep them on course and to stay focused, to keep them from worse injury. God is the same. He loves us and he corrects us because the alternative is being separated from him. And that is far worse. However, they did not listen, but they acted in accordance with their former custom. So these nations superficially feared the Lord. They also served their idols, as did their children and their children's children, just as their fathers did. So do they to this day, the date of this writing. This is why this program exists. This is why we in the family ministries, because a lot of people don't seem to get this, take everything so seriously. These people who feared God, but not really, because the idols of their past beckoned, passed their idolatry on to their children, who passed it on to their children, in a cycle of superficial, surface-level pretend love of the Lord. The children did as their fathers did. Children do as we do, not as we want them to, but as they watch and observe us. They watch us like hawks, even if it doesn't look like it. They are picking up on and internalizing every bad habit we have ever showed them, whether we know we're showing it to them or not. We take this, we in the family ministries, take everything so seriously because we need to show our children what it is to stay true and firm in our Christian walk. Because sin is crouching outside the door. The world is waiting to swallow our children whole. And if we aren't showing them how to be prepared to walk out our faith in the full armor of God, if we are only showing them that church is a weekend activity, if we are only showing them that Christian is a mask to wear around other believers and can be discarded at our earliest convenience, then they will not be able to defend themselves. They will be sheep walking into a field of wolves. We can't let our idolatry become their idolatry. Break the cycle. We need to take our faith seriously. We need to project the love we have for the Lord. Let that love be seen everywhere, every day, not just when the church building is in sight. Don't let our children end up like those who identify as Christian. Let our children be the type of Christian who couldn't possibly identify as anything else, because no one would believe them. We need to lead. So let's lead. Let's begin with our own families and lead them to and in the Lord. Show them who is important. Show them why it's important. Show them that no idol, no matter how shiny, no matter how worldly rewarding, show them that no idol, no counterfeit, no facsimile, no fake can compare to the love of our Lord. That way, when their time to choose a course comes before them, as it does for all generations, our children choose to truly fear the Lord. All right, let me calm down a bit. I got a little bit more fiery there than I expected. And let's take a few moments to praise and worship our Lord with Mr. Isaac. I hope everyone had a great time tonight, and let's close in prayer. Dear Lord, thank you so much for allowing us to once again gather this way, to once again gather together as a digital small group. I know I got a little fiery there towards the end of that lesson, but the zeal you place on my heart, Lord, for my children's future, their salvation in you. I honestly think that that is sometimes more important to me than my own salvation, Lord. And I know there are other parents who feel the very same way. So, Lord, that's what I want to pray for right now. I want to pray that our children feel the passion that we have for you. And they can hold on to that passion, Lord. And they can share in that passion. And it can stay with them for all their days. I've seen so many people that their zeal for the Lord faded. And they would pretend to be Christian for their parents. So I don't want my children to have zeal for you. And love for you and passion for you all of my days, but all of theirs. Because you are worthy of that zeal. You are worthy of that passion. You are worthy of that love. And I pray these things in the name of your son, Jesus. Amen. And with that, blessings to everyone watching. And I hope to see you again this Monday for Tilling the Soil. As we know.